Ah.
Hmm. I have a beauty waiting for me back at Winterfell. Yellow hair, blue eyes.
Tallest woman you've ever seen. Almost as tall as you.
Brienne of Tarth.
You know her?
You're with Brienne of fucking Tarth.
Well, not with her yet. But I see the way she looks at me.
How does she look at you? And she wants to carve you up and eat your liver?
You do know her.
Hey everyone, welcome to our podcast. I'm Mr. Blahg.
And I'm Duncan.
And I'm Lucy.
And I'm Jason.
And this is Game of Microphones, episode 39. Wow, we have a full house today.
Yeah, I wasn't supposed to be here.
But why
a special guest?
Why are you here? What's up, Jason? What's going on?
Because I had to miss 2 weeks ago where it was like one of the most amazing episodes ever and Danny attacked the Lannisters. And then I saw this episode and I was like, fucking A, man. I can't miss both of these.
Well, it's awesome to have you on here as always. Totally. And we are also joined by Lucy from Scotland. Lucy, yay. How you doing?
Hello, good morning. I'm doing good. It's the future here. It's Tuesday, so hello.
Whoa.
Anything exciting happened last
happen?
Night? Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, nothing catastrophic yet. Yeah. The sun hasn't come up, so I'm just kind of sitting, waiting for that to happen.
Hopefully that comes up.
Yeah, I hope so. I mean, I'll let you know if it doesn't.
Okay. Lucy is communicating to us through tachyons sent backwards in space-time.
I am. That's like exactly that. What's happening. That's just what I do. It's what we do.
So this is awesome. We're on the West Coast, East Coast, and Scotland. Great Indeed. To have everybody here. Yay. We are here to talk about Game of Thrones. The
Beyond the Wall.
Beyond the Wall.
Holy crap. I loved it. I thought it was fantastic. Do I have some quibbles? Sure, we'll get into that later. But let's get into these top three highlights. Game of Thrones, Season 7, Episode 6, Beyond the Wall. Okay, who's going to start first?
Lucy!
There we go.
I thought I heard something. I'm sitting quietly in the corner here. Are we going to go for the big stuff straight away? I mean, are we...
That's up to you.
What do we think?
Totally, whatever you want.
Okay, because I tried to... Because I know you guys are like into the battles, which I am also, but I thought I would try and pick some more... off the wall things if I could.
Sure, of course.
So the first thing I have written up is actually the women of the episode. I enjoyed very much hearing Arya's memory of breaking the rules and introducing the idea that sometimes maybe the rules are wrong rather than the people within them being wrong.
Yes.
I feel so bad for Sansa this season because I really feel like she's just doing her best and she's just getting constant shit from her slightly creepy brother, her now slightly creepy sister, and I just think, you know, I hope that there's a bigger game plan for her because at the moment I just really think, you know, she's doing her best. But the idea that she was comparing to Arya this different kind of suffering and the pain she'd endured, and Arya's just not willing to recognise that in anyone else but herself. She's still quite narcissistic in that way. So that conflict between the two sisters. I thought Dany's observations about the kind of men and the warriors around her were quite interesting. And her reaction to the final act was very stoic. Like, you didn't see her break down or scream or cry or anything. And I thought that was really, really interesting.
What was the observation that they... just go off into dangerous situations?
They do. I think they do stupid things.
Which she said right before she took her three dragons up to fight White Walkers.
Yeah, she was talking about how heroes go and get themselves killed. And I thought it was interesting because the three heroes that she mentioned were Drogo, Jorah, and Dario. And then she threw in that Jon Snow. You know,
putting him all on some level. But it's a little ironic that she's sort of criticizing him for that, and then she goes and kind of does the same thing.
Yeah, because she's a hero too, you know, what can she do?
Yeah, that's what heroes do, yeah. And that was the one time where I was like, come on, Tyrion. I totally love Tyrion in this episode, but they balance each other out, and this is where the balance needed to tip on her side. I mean, you could argue against that because she kind of suffered a huge loss, but we wanted to see her go up and take care of business.
Yeah, to change up the methodology.
Oh, go ahead, Lucy. She says she doesn't regret it. You know, like John says, sorry. And I thought it was really touching that John recognized that these were her children and not just a pet. I guess I wonder if having a direwolf makes you more aware of
sensitive.
It must, because he freaked out when that dragon went down. He, like, everybody was kind of standing still, just jaws dropped, and he started swinging his sword and, you know,
he was
eyed up the Night King and everything.
And you're right. As soon as he came to consciousness, that was his first thing was, oh, I'm so sorry. And I thought that was really touching.
Yeah.
I've written down John does a Jamie hashtag don't fuck with Bay, which I think is right. Just don't fuck with her. And the final thing about kind of the role of women in this was I really liked what the way that Arya introduced the idea of the faceless men. I thought it was a bit it was a bit movie-ish. I felt a bit like this is kind of exposition that I don't know, three seasons ago we might have had like some softcore porn instead of, you know, just a room with someone speaking. I'm not saying either is better. But the idea that because she's female, she has these faces and this anonymity that allows her to break the rules and do and mete out this justice. And yeah, I'm really interested to know what you guys thought of that scene because the bit where she gave Sansa the dagger, I still don't know that I've quite grasp what she's getting at there. Is she saying, you know, Sansa, it's your turn to kill someone, or is she saying, I'm not going to do it, watch out for me? Like, I'm sure there's someone sitting at home going, for fuck's sake, it's really obvious. But I was really intrigued by that.
Did you guys see the outtake where she's like, hello, Clarice, I mean Sansa?
No.
No, I'm just kidding. She was totally Arya Lecter in that whole scene, man.
She so was.
I saw her just turning over the knife just as sort of a, I could kill you if I want to, but you're safe right now.
Yeah.
Here it is. You can take the dagger. I'm not going to do
anything. But I'm
totally
in control of the situation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I thought that's pretty much what
that
was.
Watching this episode, watching that whole sequence, I was feeling the same way about Arya that I felt about the Waif, which is kind of interesting. Like, I fucking hate you, basically.
And,
you know, I don't like feeling that way about Arya, but she seemed like the Waif. She was cold and creepy and dangerous. And I was trying to look on, you know, and I thought it was almost unbelievable that she would act like that, but I was trying to look on devil's advocate side. And I mean, their relationship, you know, she's always thought that Sansa's this prissy girl who wants to be the queen, and that's more important to her than probably anything else. And so
the Hound has a word, I bet Arya would use.
But also, I think really the only thing that would justify her, because she, even with that, I don't think she would want to destabilize what's going on at Winterfell, where this, you know, they have Winterfell. But I think the only thing that would justify this kind of behavior, if she actually believes that Sansa might betray Jon, which is what she said. So I think that's what they're getting at, that Arya thinks Sansa might betray Jon.
Is it possible that this is Arya's way of getting to know who Sansa is now? By playing this, like, okay, go ahead and try to lie to me, to maybe try to figure out the truth as to what's going on. Because she doesn't know her sister anymore. It's been a long time, and they've both been through so much.
And they never really did pay that much, I mean, have heart-to-hearts or anything, I don't think.
No, and they and she laid it out in this, she's laid it out in this episode as well. You always wanted the pretty dresses, you wanted the fancier, you know, this has been the kind of theme. Arya wanted something drastically different.
Yeah, Dad had to convince me not to stab you with needle.
But there was this moment where, as Arya was talking about being somebody else, this is not who, it's not who they became, but now she has the power to become whoever she wants to. And then it went in a menacing town. And I think that might have just been, you know, poking and prodding to see where her weak spots are and what's really going on with her sister, possibly.
That and also just saying, don't fucking betray John or you will meet my wrath.
Yeah, I can hear me too.
Yeah.
But I'm at this point, I'm wondering if Arya killed that servant girl just so she could have her face and get close to Walder Frey. I think she seemed like she's capable of something like that.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. And, that's what I've always thought. Yeah.
And I think if she goes too far in this, if she keeps going further in this direction, she's got to go.
There's just something about it that feels, I mean, it's classic, like, you know, drama studies, isn't it? It's like, you know, put an obstacle in the way of kind of the goals.
It feels like the writers said we need to amp up the drama here.
It just feels a little manufactured in that sense. I'm just a little like, okay, I can see this would happen maybe.
You have to talk yourself into it.
A little bit. I'm just a bit like, Arya couldn't possibly look at that and think, oh, Sansa wrote that off her own back and was totally happy. And I think the argument, you know, you didn't have a knife to your neck is really unreasonable because she knows that that's not how the Lannisters operate. So, yeah, I'm kind of with you. I found Arya a bit... I enjoyed the speeches that she had and the sentiment of what she was saying, but I'm finding her actions a little difficult to follow and kind of empathize with at the moment.
Well, they've sort of hinted at something, you know, maybe her turning dark side, even in the same episode, while John and Beric are talking about being brought back. They're discussing what they're living for and who the enemies are, what they're fighting for, which is another aspect of the episode. And, you know, they decide, Beric says, I'm fighting for life, you know, and he says, death is the enemy. But what god does Arya serve? You know, the whole House of Black and White, the Faceless Men, they serve the god of death, the many-faced god. So that's an inherent conflict between the between Arya's philosophy sort of and the ideology that Jon and the Lord of Light and these guys are all sort of fighting for.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah, she's been hanging out with some crazy people with this death cult, so I'm sure that's had an impact on her outlook of the world. And I really do feel like she's channeling the Waif.
Yeah, I
think it's so funny too that you know she's collecting faces. When I made the comparison to Hannibal Lecter, but Hannibal Lecter was kind of drawn to faces too. He wore a face in the movie Hannibal, right? Yeah. When he was escaping the cage in whatever police precinct they're at, he eats people's faces. Actually. Oh, that was the original Silence of the Lambs. Okay, awesome. And he, you know, he eats people's faces, and there's like sort of a face thing with him. So I thought it was interesting that she really played that scene very Hannibal-like to me. I rewatched it, and it's all I could see when I was watching her.
Yeah, Hannibal Stark. Yeah, for sure.
Now, of course, there was also one other woman in this episode that I thought was pretty awesome.
Brienne of Tarth.
Brienne of Tarth, exactly. I mean, she was in it very shortly. But she really, you know, had that that little exchange with Sansa. She felt so conflicted. I felt so bad for her.
Yeah. And can we have like a moment of recognition that Podrick is now a competent swordsman?
Awesome. I think about that. Yeah. Oh, also with Brienne leaving, Peter Baelish had said, "Well, Brienne's sworn to serve both of you. So if one of you is trying to harm the other one in any way, Brienne would be honor bound to step in." Correct? And Sansa's like, "Yeah." And then Sansa sends Brienne away. So does that mean she's plotting to potentially harm Arya?
My theory is that's her playing to Littlefinger. She's making Littlefinger feel secure that she's doing what he thinks she's going to do, and that she's got something bigger in mind. But I couldn't put money on that.
See, I think Littlefinger's totally in control right now, and things are going according to his plan perfectly. And I kind of love that if it's true, because... that's more like how he was early on. And he's the one character, even more than Cersei, that I totally want to see get what he deserves by the end of this, which is a killing. Mm. But in the meantime, I want to see him do his thing, you know?
Yeah.
But I was sort of thinking, I didn't get that either. And I think I'm probably wrong. I shouldn't even say what I think. But I thought it was Littlefinger was trying to make Sansa fear that Brienne would hurt Arya, and so she sent Brienne away so that wouldn't happen. But
maybe
I don't know. But I think I think Littlefinger wanted Sansa to send Brienne away because that means she's even less protected.
Yeah, it's taking away, because she's the one who's seen right through Littlefinger right from the start, isn't she? She's like, nope, do not trust. And she's probably
right
the biggest. Oh, completely.
Yeah, definitely right about that.
She kind of lacks his cunning and, you know, overall sort of evil machinations, but
she's
got
judge
a good
of
gut.
Character. Yeah.
And she's just like, nope, shut it down. And she's quite right.
All right. Well, do you have anything else on your number three there?
I've just got a note that the faces look weird as hell, but that's
the masks.
Oh my god, yeah, I was a bit like, oh, what the?
You can't think too hard about those faces.
Yeah, no. I was like, you know, I'm just gonna let that one lie.
Oh, let's go to Jason.
All right, I'm gonna go straight to the dragons. this is a deeply held issue for people because those dragons are so beloved. Like,
yeah.
You know, some people, many people hate seeing any harm come to animals more than humans in shows. And, and so when I look at a show that I podcast about, I look at it from two perspectives. One is just a fan who's totally enmeshed and cares about the characters and wants to see good things for them. But then also from a storytelling perspective about what makes the most satisfying story. And so just from a purely emotional, I'll go with that first. Like when Drogon jumped over that cliff and, with Dany on him, and then the other two went too, I was like, do they all need to go? Like that?
It was right after Tyrion said, when we go to King's Landing, we'll be going to two armies and three dragons. Yeah. And I'm like, fuck, three dragons.
We'd better hope it's not two dragons.
When John's out there, with the other one against them. But when John's out there, they're all surrounded and the whites are closing in. And then Drogon comes in with the swelling music with his fire blazing. That was...
Oh, yeah.
Like,
oh,
ah, yeah, that's so
glorious.
Cool.
The dragon theme, like in all its splendor. Like,
and the snow, like just blazing paths of fire across snow just bursting out
everywhere.
Yeah.
It was amazing.
It was incredible.
It was like Lord of the Rings or something, like that kind of scale, you know. Although
I mean, I could easily say
I think it was better.
This is one of the most badass things I've ever seen on TV.
Yeah.
For sure.
Oh, on TV, no question. This is like beyond anything.
Or film
on TV.
Even.
Yeah. Film so, in general,
And then...
We just got, dragons versus zombies.
Yeah, that's what we've been waiting for.
That's fucking awesome. Yeah, exactly.
Dragons versus zombies and necromancers.
And then we'll throw in a few other things too. Why not? It's just like we had dragons and zombies. Like, oh my God.
Yeah, that's so cool.
Dragons and zombies
that's
and zombie bears.
That's why I wanted to podcast. Because it's dragons versus zombies.
This moment of like sitting there just thinking... This is it. This is Ice and Fire. And that was pretty cool. Like, I was sitting there just thinking, this is what we thought we wouldn't ever see, really. The rate Gurm was writing his books. We were like, that might happen one day.
And then as soon as the Night King picked up that ice spear,
I was like, oh, fuck.
Like, they're not going to do another... I knew right away, they're not going to do another Bronn... nail machine.
And that was total foreshadowing for this.
One's gonna hit. And then he goes and does his Olympic javelin throw, and it was really vicious. Viserion, there's so much blood, and he would have gone for Drogon, but then Viserion was flying overhead.
The flame just comes bursting out of his neck where he got hit.
And blood
just,
too.
And the way he falls is just so brutal.
Slams into the ice, and then he's just all limp, and then he sinks into the cold water, and that was really, really sad.
Really sad. Yeah, the way his nose pointed upwards as he sank, and like it was like the Titanic, like going right down.
And then you see, you know, everybody's quiet for a minute, just taking it in, and then John, like you said, he just gets more pissed than I think I've ever seen him.
And one thing I really liked about that scene too is it pans left over the faces of everybody sitting on the dragon, and Tormund is just like, his mind is blown. The Hound is like, what the fuck happened? You know, Jorah's sitting there, and when it pans over to Daenerys next to Jorah, you see Jorah look over at her to see her reaction, and like, you know, he's concerned about her.
Jorah really understands the meaning of that, I think, more than anyone there, because he saw her with the eggs, and he's really been there from the very start. And
That's so true.
Speaking of the start, I'm gonna read the passage from the books on my Still Smug this week where the dragons are hatched.
Oh, God, my heart. So I can't do it.
Okay, so now here's why I think this was, that why I appreciate all this. Mm-hmm. And I think a big part of the appeal of Game of Thrones is how much it makes you feel. And a part of that is heartbreak and despair. And it's been like that since the very beginning. And one of my favorite comic book writers right now is Tom King, and he said it's his job as a writer to make us feel uncomfortable so he can make us feel comfortable again.
Yeah.
And that kind of comfort is more satisfying when you've like gone through something like this. And I think Game of Thrones does that so well. And it's necessary for a really good story for the good guys to see these dark times. And if the dragons just went and kicked ass, then we wouldn't need another season because they would just defeat everybody and
roast the Night King.
That'd be
right
it.
There.
Yeah. So, and also one thing I really like about zombies is it's the tragedy of your loved ones being turned into monsters that can turn against you, and that's going to happen now with Viserion. And when he got turned in the blue eye, I was simultaneously channeling both of these perspectives because I was like, oh no. And I was like, oh yes, this is so cool.
Yeah, same here. I think a lot of people were like really, really
upset,
mentally damaged by the dragon going down. But I had just been expecting it for so long and like looking forward to that story arc that I was sad, you know, but I was excited at the same time. And I think the excitement sort of overrode the what should have been a sad moment because I knew what was coming already, you know.
I have two things to say. Jason, you like zombies.
Yeah. And zombies are what zombies are about, you know, if you really like go back to Night of the Living Dead. Well, not even but it's like your grandma suddenly is trying to eat you. You know, it's sad. Oh. It's tragic.
Totally, totally. And I have a question for Duncan, but I don't know if it's spoilery or not. You'll probably edit this out. But it's about the three heads of the dragon.
Mm.
Where do you stand on that now?
I stand that, you know, John's gonna ride Rhaegal like his father Rhaegar. Mm-hmm. The Night King's gonna be piloting that dragon from afar or whatever, Viserion. But Bran's gonna warg into it and then let Tyrion ride him. So
that's where I'm at as well. That's thank brilliant. You. I'm glad I'm not barking up the wrong tree here.
The only other thing I had to say about all this is I wonder if zombie or white Viserion will be as intelligent and strong and dexterous as the living Viserion, because it seems like the whites are, they're really vicious, but they're not really intelligent, you know? They kind of just
follow
orders.
That's why you
need
a warg. Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. So when the Night King is controlling him.
Interesting to see how Viserion is when he...
Oh, one thing I really liked, too, was how personal it was with the Night King. You know, he's probably wanted a dragon for thousands of years. And he finally has one. He's got the chains already, you know? Drags that bastard out of the water.
Yeah, that was so cool, too, just how he got him all working to...
Oh yeah, he's seen Bran in visions and stuff. So he might be having visions of the future and like knew the dragons were coming, so he had the spears ready. Knew that there one was going to be in the lake, so he had the chains ready. You know what I mean? Who knows? But I really liked how it was personal for him. It was like something special, and he walked down to it. Everybody parted out of the way, and he knelt down and touched it. Like it was just a really like cool moment that it was, you know, showed how serious it was.
One thing I want to say about the Night King, and I think we have to give it up for this dude. Every time we actually do see him in battle, he never fails to amaze us. I mean, think back to Hardhome where he was just like, come at me, bro. You know, when everybody rises up. Now we have him as... Exactly. Now we have him as the Olympic javelin thrower, which was just spectacular. He had amazing form.
Yeah, geez,
great
wow.
shape. For such an undead guy, he really is in great shape.
His form was really good too. The arm stretch pointing in the direction.
I mean, he's a very like he's a Renaissance man. You know, he's got interests. He's good at javelin. He likes dragons. He can warg. You know, he's cool. What can I say? You know, I've got a bit of sympathy. No, I don't. Well, but you know,
look at all the people. Look at all the whites he's nurturing. He's nurturing and caring. He brought all those people back to life. I mean,
yeah. Plus, like they say, it takes 10,000 hours to become a master at something, and he's had 10,000 years. So, you know, 8,000 years. So
he's highly misunderstood.
I think so. I like the idea that he's just been sitting watching like YouTube videos of baby dragons, and they all know that he really wants a dragon. Aww. So they're like, "Oh, finally, yay!"
I keep thinking
he doesn't
maybe
even
he's
have
actually
to be
Bran,
dead, like me.
Yeah. Some people think that.
Yeah. Well, I think he looks. Kind of strange. Like for the big bad, I feel like the guy with the beard that you see behind him, like his second in command, looks more like what you would think maybe the big evil big bad would look like. And there's something about the Night King, but I quite like that because it's a bit,
oh yeah, me too,
he's quite
against type like, a little.
Yeah, and he's just very calm, and that's almost creepier. It's like the Halloween mm-hmm. thing.
He's
yeah.
so confident.
Yeah. Says anything.
Yeah.
Well, going back to the Hannibal thing, right? The gentleman killer.
Yeah.
But he's also got the attitude, you know, like, I'll fucking take care of you. I barely even need to move.
Yeah, exactly. He's just like, yeah.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Jason, anything else on the dragons?
Nope.
Duncan, number all right. three.
My number three is the talk of babies and succession in this episode.
Dude,
a lot of baby talk. You know, yeah. Tormund talking about making babies with Brienne. Big bad monsters like George Foreman who had just conquered the entire world. And Jorah tells Jon he hopes the sword will serve him well. Longclaw, that was a crazy moment too when he love says that he's forfeited his right to claim Longclaw. It was really, really emotional and intense. And
yeah, because when he gave the sword to him, I was in a room of other people and they're like, what?
Oh my God. Yeah.
It did seem like a bit of a, I did worry for Jorah at that point. I was like, oh, are you maybe going to not make the episode?
But they were all having little moments. And because one of them was having all these moments, I'm like,
I really thought that Jorah was going to die this episode going into it. I didn't think he was coming back out. But he tells Jon he hopes the sword serves him well and his children to come. And my first time I was like, wow, you know, that's really cool. And then the second time I was like, wait. He saw the way that Jon and Dany were looking at each other. He just wants Dany's kids to have his sword.
Aww.
I think Thoros is the one I care the least about.
Yeah, he was.
He was the red shirt
care,
of the seven.
He is the red shirt, but he's also... When you lose Thoros, you lose your ability to bring people back to life. So he's quite a loss
That's why he had to die, you know?
Yeah, exactly. So it was like their get-out-of-jail-free card is gone.
Do
I thought he did an amazing performance. Yeah, do not pass go. Do not be resurrected by the Lord.
Do not collect dragon glass. I don't know.
Yeah, do not collect dragon glass.
Which obviously they didn't.
I know.
What the hell? Yeah.
They should have rode in on horses, and had a bunch of bows with dragon glass arrowheads. Could have taken care of the problem like that.
Yeah. 300%.
Then it would have sucked.
Yeah, no, it would have been really sensible and over in like 5 minutes.
So. Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe it could have been cool, but so he's talking about children with Jon there, implying that Jon will have children, and then Dany tells Jon she can't have kids, and it could have been interpreted as her just impressing on Jon how important the dragons are to her, but I think she was. You know, it was right after John had grabbed her hand after waking up, and they made like a personal connection.
You should know this
connection.
If anything's going to happen between us.
Yeah, exactly. Like do you what did she say? She said,
"You understand." And she, it had also been mentioned with Tyrion too early on.
Yeah,
right.
So they keep mentioning that. So it seems like, I mean, why can't she have kids? I don't remember.
During the curse, the black magic ritual with Miri Mazdur. That basically, in the aftermath of that, she said that she would no longer be able to have kids.
See, I bet you that'll be reversed somehow.
Yeah. Well, I heard people speculating. I was on Behind the Iron Throne, hashtag BTIT. I heard one of them on there talking about how, you know, if only death can pay for life, maybe the sacrifice of Viserion to attempt to save Jon and, you know, the whole world, maybe that death will pay for the life of a new child for Dany.
Yeah. That's interesting.
Sort of the way that Rhaego, her child Drogo, paid for Drogo's life and then subsequently potentially the dragons.
I think it's quite interesting from John's perspective because in the book, certainly when he's falling for Ygritte and he has a lot of angst and upset about the thought of bringing a bastard into the world. Like he's really that horrifies him. And
that's
I don't
why he
know
never
whether...
goes to brothels or anything either.
Yeah, he's like, it's too shameful, it's too kind of, it's just too bad of a thing that he can't even contemplate it. I just wonder where he's at with kids, you know, if I was on a date with John, not that that would happen, but if I was, you know, I'd love to know where he's at with if he wants kids, you know, but it's quite interesting because he is still, to all intents and purposes, a bastard, but he's a bastard who's a king. So.
So. Yeah, he could legitimize himself or anybody else for that matter. But, I think that he would be like all about kids because he took a special liking to Ollie. You know,
what happened with that?
Yeah, yeah. Maybe that's a sign that he should not be having kids.
It runs in his family, though. Ned was always obsessed with the kids. Like, he sees Catelyn when he comes home from hunting. He's like, how are the kids? You know, immediately, like, Ned was all about the kids. He's sacrificed his honor he would like to save his kids. Yeah.
But who knows?
Obviously, Ned's not John's dad, but I just feel like it's like a family trait of the Starks. Like, they're really into their, you know, children and everything.
They're a wolf pack. Yeah, they're wolf pack.
They're pack. Yeah, they're cubs.
Aww.
So that was my number three, babies in succession. And yeah, the talk with Tyrion about, you know, who's going to succeed her, what kind of system they want to put in place. I thought that was really cool. It played into the idea of what are we fighting for when Beric was talking with Jon as well. Like, are we fighting for a monarchy? Are we fighting for representative government? Do we want to have succession based on, you know, the eldest male heir? Do we want to do it some different way of voting, like the Night's Watch? Do we want a King's Moot?
Tyrion's hinting at what you want to see.
He's totally hinting towards constitutional republic, representative government type stuff, which I think is awesome. I was, you know, really excited to hear that. Yeah, he's just, the concept doesn't exist, so he's struggling on how to explain it. He's got the socio-political mind to design this, but he's struggling with the terminology and how to express it properly to Dany. And she thinks she's, you know, he's just trying to put a plan in place to, you know, to usurp some after she dies, essentially, or something like that. But
I think it's pretty exciting. Iron Islands, and they're basically a democracy, aren't they? They're kind of a straw poll democracy. They do hustings and introduce themselves, and then people kind of vote by, I don't know, screaming or something.
Yeah, but, it depends. Yeah. Sometimes it's hereditary monarchy, and then at other times they have what's called a King's Moot.
The King's Moot, yeah.
Yeah, the people show up and basically explain to the crowd why they should be king, and the crowd decides at the end who gets it, basically. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it'll be exciting to see where it goes. I hope Tyrion figures it out.
Yeah.
Very cool. Well, thank you, Duncan.
Thank you.
All right, my number three, the cinematography. I thought the filming of this particular episode was fantastic. I think I remember when Fargo came out, the film, the Coen brothers talking about the difficulty of making such a completely bleak and white landscape somehow exciting, somehow riveting to watch. And ever since hearing that, I've always paid attention to movies that do have that white bleak. Jason, you just watched The Thing recently, which I think is another great example of a movie that uses that bleak landscape to great effect. And I thought they did a phenomenal job with everything north of the wall.
Mm-hmm. They
use the landscape beautifully. That beautiful black rock against the white snows. They use the height and you know, looking down when they finally start seeing some of the dead showing up, I thought was just gorgeous. Oh,
it was phenomenal.
Or when they're trudging into the blizzard and you can't even see with a bear.
That was anything.
And it's scary as hell.
Polar bear, yeah.
Zombie polar bear.
And he's sitting there on fire growling at the hound, and the hound freezes up like Theon did a couple episodes ago. PTSD. Yep.
Yeah. But as far as cinematography, it was just they're in this strange, unknown land, at least for everyone but Tormund, and just to have it be where you can't even see several feet in front of you.
And they use
it was like that episode of The Walking Dead where they're all in the fog, remember?
Yeah, that was really that was a long time ago. But it was, you even saw the bear paws. John's looking down and he sees them going off into the mist.
Right.
That's all you can see. And it's just like, oh my God, what other horrible things lurk in that fog? You know?
Beautiful, yes.
And while we're talking about the bear, I think Game of Thrones does this thing where a scene can serve two purposes. They do that a lot. And I think this scene was a badass fucking zombie bear attacking, and it was awesome. But B, it was just a reminder that, the White Walkers can turn beasts. So that it would echo at the end.
Jason, get the fire with Sandor going on as far as his fear, a reminder of that.
And that Thoros probably got Tormund, what's his name, killed.
Absolutely. Totally got Thoros whacked.
Yeah.
Well, what was that great line he said? I just got bit by a bear. I mean, he was
He says, where is it? I just funny got bit life. By a dead bear.
That's you did. It.
Funny old life.
Love that. God, R.I.P. Thoros. Seriously. Even though he may have been the biggest red cloak of the whole group, he at least, I don't know, he had that great fare thee well. He got some good one-liners in there. Cauterizing his wound. Ugh.
As the red priest, he was definitely the biggest red cloak.
Yeah. Yeah, I've seen that guy, Paul Kay, on stage before. He's really? Actually really good. Yeah, actually, weirdly, in a musical.
What did he do on stage?
I saw him in, do you know,
Matilda? You saw him acting?
Yeah, Matilda, nice. The musical. He was Mr. Wormwood, and he was really good. But so it was quite funny, because I just had this flashback where I was like, oh yeah, I remember that. But he's brilliant, so good. And he's got this fantastic look about him. He just looks a bit supernatural almost.
He plays the ukulele too, but I'll talk about that later in the news.
Very good. All right, well, so my number three, cinematography. Lucy, what's your number two?
Right, so kind of touched on it actually a little bit, was the family and parentage aspect of the episode. So constant references to the future and Succession, so we've kind of covered that. I quite like the Tyrion and Dany interaction, because I was watching it the second time and I was thinking, what's the actual tone here? And it's almost a family kind of tone. Like, although they're bickering, there's a sort of mutual respect there that is almost parental in the way that Tyrion's speaking to Dany. She's going, you know, when have I lost my temper? And he's like, well, when you burned the Tarleys. And she's like, that didn't rip. Yeah, you went last week when you burned the people.
And it's great too how they'll bicker and then they'll be, you know, back together again, like everything's good. Just
Yeah. And I think it's the way she's kind of going, I want to break the wheel. And he's like, yeah, but you're just going to create your own wheel. And this idea, you know, he's saying to her, this is how wheels are created, is by repeating these patterns of behavior. And she says, you know, what is it? She says, which war was won without deceit and murder? And what Tyrion's desperately trying to do is kind of put across this idea of a new politics, a new way of doing things. Mm-hmm. So I really like their dynamic. A couple of episodes ago, I was concerned that Tyrion was maybe in danger slightly because his advice had been not great on a couple of occasions. In fact, most of the occasions. But I feel like there's this almost familial thing between the two of them where she recognises that she doesn't need him as almost a devil's advocate to come up against. There were also memories of Ned throughout the episode. He was there a lot in terms of what people were talking about, and Beric saying to Jon, you know, you must take after your father, kind of thing. We got a reference to Viserys, kind of a long forgotten family member.
He said you don't take after your father, you must take after your mother.
Yes, you must favor your mother. Yeah.
Because you don't look anything like that guy.
Yeah, you're like, oh, but and yet you look like a Stark. This is confusing. And I liked the idea that the death of Viserion is more than just losing one of their weapons. It's almost like the death of a child to be avenged. Like, Dany's got an emotional stake in this war now that has maybe been missing up till now. You know, she just knows
that
it's her birthright.
Good point. Yeah.
Good
point.
Yeah. Whereas now she's like, you fucking killed my dragon. Are you kidding me?
And not only has she seen this threat, so now she's fully invested, but she's got a vengeance motive too. So
yeah. Watch out. And it's like, you know, Cersei's a mother and Dany's mother, you know, there's the don't fuck with mothers basically would be the upshot of this, I think.
It's in your motherfucker.
She's got a lot of motives too. She's got the motive to help John too, now that she's like obviously got a thing for him.
Mm-hmm. Yep, the ship is definitely heading to Bone Town. So that was it, kind of family, parents, lineage. And I guess Jorah's reference to his father as well ties in with that. I thought it was a sweet kind of thing to have, giving a sense of sort of payoff to a lot of the things that are happening now.
Yeah, absolutely. This season's all about that.
Totally.
You know, it's you mentioned Mormont. It got me thinking about when Sansa and Arya were talking and they mentioned Lyanna Mormont.
Right.
Almost made me forget. Yeah. I'm like, oh my God,
what
that's
would little
right.
Lady Lyanna that's, think?
That's, yeah, and that's Jorah's relative. I don't even remember how close they are. It must be
a nephew, a niece even?
Maybe. Maybe a niece. cousin, second cousin. I don't know, but they're related. I'm like, okay, so the Mormonts are still in play here. And
we got talk of Jorah Mormont. We saw Jorah and talk of Lyanna Mormont.
It's quite interesting because they're not a disgraced house per se, but with what Jorah did and with him kind of his allegiance to the Night's Watch and being Lord Commander there, they're almost like a black sheep house. Not that they're bad, but they're kind of on the back burner. And I guess what that's reminding us when you talk about Lyanna Mormont is there is a future there for that house. We're concerned about what's going to happen to all these old houses where people have died, but there are other houses whose time might be coming.
I hate to go into something like this. This may be reading way too much into it, but I wonder if there's any symbolism because, their family sigil being the bear.
Yeah.
The zombified polar bear coming at them being a rotted version of their family. I don't know. I think this is reaching.
Maybe it just foreshadows a dead Jorah.
No, come. Yeah. If you wrote that in a literature essay, I would give you marks for symbolism. I'd be like, yes. Good analysis. So go with it.
They're first cousins, by the way, according to Wikia. Okay.
I did think it was so funny. Ultimate guilt trip as well. Like, what would Lyanna think? That little girl? And I was just like,
she's younger than you were. Exactly.
But they're just different. And I agree with, like, Sansa's grown up. She's doing so well. And I was so mad at Arya. Come on, can't you see she's...
at Littlefinger.
I think that's the thing, is Arya just comes off as the immature little sister. She comes off as
this is just what Cersei would want us to be fighting.
I'm gonna kill you. Yeah, she's like, I don't fucking care, I'm gonna kill you. You did this.
And you just think, is your face.
Yeah. And I don't think Arya understands that there are other ways to suffer. I think she's living in a world of violence. Whereas what Sansa's lived through is a very different kind of horror. Political horror and a sexual horror. And I just think, you know, Arya, grow up, read the room. So I guess that ties in with family as well, because she's basically being like a pain in the ass. But so those kind of things. I thought that was quite an interesting line to carry through the episode.
Also, this is also a good reminder of how young these two girls both are.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, they've both had to mature very quickly for their ages. But as you were saying all of that, I'm like, oh my God, that's right. Maisie Williams, Arya, she looks a lot like my youngest daughter, so it's always a little unnerving for me. especially on this one, I was like,
if she starts wanting to go to like weird summer camps where she's like, I don't know, it's just somewhere, it's like sword fighting and stuff.
We're learning carving, yeah.
Yeah,
exactly.
Maybe don't let her.
I'm gonna worry.
With how young they are and how much, you know, how impressionable and everything they both are still, it's tragic that they're not just working together as well, because they could both learn so much from each other about totally different styles of leadership and strategy that they've learned, that like combine those together and it would be super powerful.
And that's exactly what Tyrion explicitly says to Dany, which I think is so cool, when she's like, oh, sympathizing with your family, are you, or whatever way she phrased it. And he's like, well, yeah, actually, because to understand your enemy, you have to think
siding
like
with
them.
Your family.
Siding with your family. And he's like, in this case, because I need to know. And it's that maturity that is lacking from the Stark girls' interactions on Arya's part. Because she's like, why would you ever, you know, So, that's my number two. The sun is just coming up. I'm still like, I'm almost finished my teas. So I'll get more coherent.
We know we're safe.
you've been very coherent, and as you're getting more coherent, I'm drinking more wine, so it's becoming this wonderfully inverse sort of thing going on.
Beautiful.
By the end of the podcast, I'll be the last one standing. Hello.
Something like I that, said, yeah. Lucy did a great job last podcast, so I knew she was going to deliver big this time too.
No, you guys, no.
Jason, what's your number two?
Okay, so I loved everything with the whites, aka the Game of Thrones zombies, in this episode. We talked about the bear. I liked that they went zombie hunting, even though it might not, it's kind of a crazy idea. And they happened to find this like marching group of whites with one lone white walker. And I did think it was a little silly that they killed him, and it just so happened that he turned all of them except for one. That's
how
pretty
cool
convenient.
Was that, though?
It was cool that they all dropped,
So there's, I think we're learning something about them now. Even at one point, well, never mind. Keep going. Sorry.
Well, let's talk about the nature, because we're so used to the Walking Dead zombies, and these are not them. They're magical, and they're, a white actually, some people I notice online are spelling it W-H-I-T-E-S.
Mm-hmm. Right, good point, but Jason.
These are W-I-G-H-T mm-hmm. whites. They're,
it's not the whites, it's whites.
Yeah, yeah. They might be white Jesus supremacists, Christ. But it would still be W-I-G-H-T.
Yeah.
Dead lives matter, bro.
They're spirit, ghost, or other supernatural beings, but they don't have the same rules as walkers or zombies. They the hound actually got bitten, I think, and that doesn't mean anything because I think you need a white walker to turn a dead person into a white.
Yeah. Although, and half of them are like missing half their heads and stuff.
Yeah, and they're skeletal, like Jason and the Argonauts or something.
Right.
Okay, just again, pause just to give absolute. The one that Sandor's throwing the rock at and it hits the jaw.
Oh my
the
god!
First
yeah.
one to walk yeah. out onto the with the big oversized
he's
boots.
He's like, "Hey,
why don't you do that? Ice amazing. Didn't break. Everything about that dude.
That was hilarious.
I'm assuming it was
I'm like,
but it was
you
awesome.
Couldn't just leave well enough alone, could you? And then my friend who was I was watching it with is like, "Yeah, he never does. He jabs at everything.
Yeah, he's like a petulant child."
It reminded me of Carl with the zombie
yes.
stuck in the mud who got out and killed Dale.
Yeah.
And I liked that one that screamed, you know, rah! For his
yeah.
friends.
Yeah.
That was pretty yeah. cool.
Stay and, in the house, Sandor.
And I think, you know, I really feel like Game of Thrones does zombies better than The Walking Dead in general. Probably the budget has something to do with that. But it's also, you know, the more that The Walking Dead goes on, I'm like, maybe they should have had fast zombies because if you're going to try to keep manufacturing terrifying situations, the fast ones are a lot more scary.
Yeah, I miss those Darabont zombies, man, that had like a little bit of intelligence left. And like,
absolutely.
Yeah. I thought these were more in the style of kind of 28 Days Later or Train to Busan.
Yeah, and the way they growl.
Yes. Oh, yeah, I like that a lot.
Yeah. So one guy screamed when they captured him and alerted all the rest.
Yeah.
That was that scream.
Yeah.
Now, here is something I noticed with that zombie, or the white, excuse me, when Sandor kicks him, did you notice, this is when they're all surrounded, he kicks him and all of a sudden you hear like this rumbling through the whole
they're all
white
networked
crowd. It got
together.
Me thinking. Yeah, it's like a hive mind, right? Mm-hmm. So,
right.
But are they only linked together with the ones who share mutual resurrection juju? You know,
right.
Like the way that we
like
saw
the
ones
somebody
that controlled
said
by the same necromancer.
It was kind of funny.
Yeah,
they're
like,
you know, what are we going to do here? Oh, why don't we just go after those guys? And then it's like it was almost like a Naked Gun episode or something. They're like. All of a sudden you see the four White Walkers just a few feet away. but he's like, that guy right there turned all of these. Now, I don't know how he could have known that or if he was serious, but it did just sort of give the impression that the Night King turned most of them.
Well, he lifted his arms and they just whoop, rose en masse.
And that's another thing that's different with these zombies than Walking Dead is that they're totally under the control of the White Walkers, as we saw with
the
chains.
Necromancy aspect.
Yeah, I mean he's patient zero basically, isn't he? The night King. He's the first. Have any of you read the Passage series by Justin Cronin? It's kind of zombie vampires.
No.
It's a shout out to anyone who is into that kind of thing. It's really really good. Series.
Our friend Lisa just sent me the first book of that.
It's really good, and it's a really similar system of how the beasts get turned into what they are. They each have kind of a father beast, so there's seven of them and they all communicate through this kind of hive mind, and I quite like the idea that the whites and the White Walkers kind of have that too. I think that's pretty terrifying. Mm-hmm.
Definitely. And thank you, Lisa, for the book.
Yay.
Similar to Stephen King's Cell, by the way, which is a good book if the zombies are all kind of hive mindy in that. And then the last thing, it's just the whole sequence with they're on this little island in the middle of a frozen over lake and a hordes of whites surrounding them. And then the fight was just so spectacular. I love seeing that. I mean, a little ridiculous how many there were, but it was cool seeing the hound
with the hammer.
Oh yeah.
Awesome. Smashing the ground.
They're calling this the Battle of the Frozen Lake, by the way. That's what,
and then the red shirts, there were some red shirts that just got swallowed up by hordes of hordes.
That
of
reminded me of the Battle of the Bastards when Jon was almost buried alive.
Me too, sort
of.
Even saw a spray of blood like coming up out of when they ripped into the one
And there's like one of them just looking up at the camera going, rah!
Yeah.
Oh, it was awesome. Brilliant. I'm confused, a little confused, and this isn't a nitpick, this is genuine confusion, about their relationship with water. So they couldn't cross water, but yet when they go in it, they don't seem to die, per se. They seem to be able to live in it.
Well, they didn't want to cross because the lake was going to break, but then I think it got cold enough that it froze over and was solid enough.
Yeah, no, I got that bit, but I was just, I got that bit. I just wondered when they went down, like when John went underwater with some of them, they didn't really seem to drown. They seemed to keep going. And I was just a bit like, oh, okay, so can they exist under the water?
And I think so.
Yeah, they seem to be popping up out of the water to grab Tormund and...
That was the other thing that I got. I thought that was quite horrifying.
Oh God, I thought it was like Friday the 13th. I thought he was gone. I did not like that one bit. I was very upset. That was pissing me off. I was yelling at my TV. I'm like,
me too, screaming at the TV.
Save him, Hound! Sandor's friend!
The more I see Tormund, the more I love Tormund.
I love
Tormund's facial expression is like how I feel most days, just that bewildered, like, what's happening? I'm like, yep, that's my life.
Yeah, he's always got the wild eyes.
Just but bring up the...
Every time he gets teased or insulted, he's just tickled by it, which I love.
I love.
Yeah, when he was like, talking with the Hound.
Called a cocksucker, and he just laughs it off.
By the way, Hound's Jason, like, fuck off. The thing, we were talking about the thing earlier, there is that prequel that came out a few years ago. He's in it.
Tormund. I might watch that.
I have to say, I love that movie. Actually, I really, really like it.
I'm going to check it out. Because you know this girl she was in Fargo season 3. She was in
Mary Elizabeth 10 Winstead.
Cloverfield Lane. Yeah. I really like her, so I got to check it out.
That's Ramona Flowers,
man. He is also in the critically acclaimed Fate of the Furious. He plays a bad guy in Fast 8. Yeah.
Ooh, he plays Tormund? A bad guy?
Oh. Yeah. Yeah,
nice. He's great in the thing though, because he's European.
He's inherently evil if it's a Fast and the Furious movie, but yeah. Sorry, that's not true. Miss Sandy's not evil in the Fast and the Furious films, but yeah. Anyway, so
she's in that too. Oh, cool.
Yeah, she's like a sexy hacker in the Fast. And then the
I've only seen the third one, Tokyo Drift. Sorry, let's not.
I gotta get into the. I haven't seen any. The one thing I wanted to touch on is. We've seen Jon Snow facing totally impossible odds or just squaring off against basically a horde in Battle of the Bastards where it's like, well, he's dead, but then he gets saved because his army comes charging in. And here he gets saved by Mr. Deus Ex Machina, Benjen Stark, who saved Bran. And Benjen! So I saw that, Lucy, you had said that his killing style was similar to some kind of a Scottish tradition or something.
Yes!
There's this thing in Stonehaven, which is, I was actually just up near there at the weekend. Every Hogmanay / New Year's Eve, they do a fireball procession, which is like little cages filled with fire that you kind of spin in interesting patterns and things. It's a pretty relatively new thing. It's like 200, 300 years. Yeah, in Scotland, that's relatively new. But it does date back, I think, to some kind of pagan traditions as well. So I was watching that, like, that would be a cool way to kind of...
Looks just fight. Like it, too.
Yeah, and it's quite medieval as well with the... this is going to embarrass the fact that I'm a medievalist and can't remember the name of them, but the balls with spikes on that you can spin around and...
Mace?
Morning Star.
Yes, all of those. Let's go with all of them. But yeah, if you're ever in Scotland over New Year, head up to the northeast. And they also do a thing a couple of weeks later, further up the coast, called Burning the Clavey, which is like a kind of, it's sort of, I don't want to say Wicker Man, because, you know, we don't burn anyone as far as I know, but it's...
Nicolas Cage isn't there either.
Yeah, the bees! It's sort of a pagan fire festival thing, so it was quite cool to see that. I was like, oh, Benjen, maybe you're secretly a bit Scottish. That's cool.
It was cool. Why didn't Benjen just get on the horse, though? Come on.
Oh my God, why the fuck not? That was such a Titanic moment. I'm like, there's room for both of you.
There's no time. Let me explain. If I get on the horse, it will take at least 3 seconds, and by that time, they'll probably get us, so I'm just going to stand here.
There's not enough room on that wooden door. I mean, on that horse.
Yeah, literally that really did annoy me. I was like, oh, I think because I quite like Benjen. I was like, oh, but also, you know, whatever.
I always get the feeling going to Scotland, I would just die.
Really? I'd be in heaven with all the scotch.
Well, I was going to say, I'd actually probably just drink myself to death. But other than that.
Both are possible. We're actually super friendly. Like, we sound scary, but we're not. We're actually super friendly.
Yeah, no, I... never mind. I love the Scots. Okay.
The temperature is not great, but.
Yeah. Not really, do. Jason, did you have anything more on that one?
Nope.
Duncan.
All right. My number two is the dialogue throughout the entire episode, but mainly between the Eastwatch 7, just the different ways that they were. Yeah, there were different things that they were talking about. We had, you know, Tormund talking about making babies with Brienne. So sweet. And the Hound shitting all over Tormund. And they're like, you know, he's not putting up with any of his bullshit. He's talking down to him, and Tormund loves it because he's like, this guy's cool. You know, I can dig this guy. He's a real guy, you know.
My favorite was when he said, you're with fucking Brienne of Tarth. Well, not yet, but I see the way she looks at me.
Yeah,
when how does she look at you like she wants to carve you and eat your liver? You do know her.
That's the best.
That was the most romantic moment of the entire episode right there.
I love how excited so Tormund was. He's like, oh, yeah. And I was like, oh, that's quite endearing.
Really?
And then he almost died, and you're like, no.
I know. No.
And that was a horrific way. He almost died. It's still, I'm going to have nightmares of this.
Screaming like for help. Help me. Oh, man.
And then the Hound giving Gendry shit for, that was what you were just saying, huh? For whinging. You know, your mouth is moving and you're complaining. He's died 7 times.
don't hear him complaining. I love that. Yeah, picking on the new guy. And then even Thoros gives him a drink and he's like, good lad. And then just like bounces right off of him. Kind of
and he's all,
she
got me in bed and I was naked. Well, it sounds all right so far.
Naked too.
Was that Beric or Sander that said? I think that was Sander.
Sander, yeah.
Oh, that was so funny.
We found out Tormund likes dick.
The word. I think he likes the word.
The word.
It makes it very clear. Yeah, exactly.
And just having all of them together, they decided, well, let's just pair off different pairs and see how they play off of each other. And I thought it worked really well.
Everybody's picking on Gendry too. Like even like they're talking about he's, you know, the best things to do in the North are fighting something and fucking, right? And Gendry's like, there's not a living woman within 100 miles of here. And he's like, we got to make do with what we got.
And when Gendry, they sent him off, you know, go back to Eastwatch, you're the fastest one. And he goes running off. I was like, we won't see him for 4 more seasons.
Yeah.
If that were any other season, yes. But now.
Right.
What about Jorah having that chat with Thoros about Thoros's amazing moment of bravery?
Right. Yeah.
How drunk were you? I didn't even remember it.
I don't remember doing it.
Yeah. I thought you were the bravest man I'd ever seen. Oh, no. I was just the drunkest.
And Tormund's talk about, it smells like pig shit down south. And, you know, John's like, you've never been down south. He's like, I've been to Winterfell. He's like, that's the north.
Now, this, I have to say, I am so in Gendry's corner in this because I have never seen snow either.
What?
I've seen some like crunchy bullshit, you know, at the end of the like frost. Just ice stuff. But I've never seen snow. I grew up in Southern California. I lived in Hawaii. I used to vacation in Mexico.
What if I like dragged you to Tahoe? Would you be like, no, I want to stay pure and never see snow?
I'd go
and I have the car to go. Everybody's been trying to get me to go for years. And people are like, dude, you have a Jeep. Why are you not going up to Tahoe? And I'm like, why would I want to do that when there's mud? I'm afraid of snow. I wouldn't know what to do with it.
I cannot get my head around that. That's insane. Like when I was young, when I was a kid, when I was at school, we got like 2 or 3 weeks off every year because of snow, because people just couldn't physically get to the school. Like it was completely
normal. Why would you want to live there? I don't understand.
I
live places with sunshine.
Because that's when you put the shag rug down, you got a nice fire going with your lady. That's in the, you know, the snow.
It's like places like Boston. I love Boston, and I would actually consider moving there in a heartbeat if it wasn't for the winters. I also have something called Raynaud's disease where I have circulation issues in my hands and my feet. Mary has this, Jason. So I'll actually like turn all blue and possibly get gangrenous if I'm in the cold too long. But
can
that's an excuse.
Can I call
that's
you sweet summer child? Is that acceptable?
Yes.
I would love it because I'm so far removed from a sweet summer child, but please, yes.
The summer part is accurate.
It's okay. Pete refers to me as a wildling because I come from the north, so it's fine.
Are you kissed by fire?
Sadly not, but I've kind of got the grumpy stoicism of the North, so I'll take it.
All right, looks like we have our ice and fire. I'm feeling like we're the third and fourth wheel here, Duncan.
I do have a red beard.
You do.
Well, there's the Norwegian in me as well. But Duncan, anything else?
Yeah, I liked the part where John calls her Danny.
Oh yes!
Oh my god! Hilarious. Yes, that was wonderful.
And she's like, "Oh, who called me Danny last? My fucking brother. He's a douchebag. He's like, so not Danny." Yeah.
And I didn't realize that because I think I call her that sometimes, and now I feel like I should not.
Right? No, I know. I do it all the time too. Every time I say it now, I'm like, I'm thinking twice about it. But it's so funny that because we've never heard anybody call her Danny in years, if ever. I don't know if
Viserys, he did. Every Viserys article, every article calls her Danny.
I wondered if it was a bit of like fan service there, having it in. Uh-huh. Yeah.
I thought.
I think Jorah did sometimes. Maybe not. I don't know.
That'd be too familiar.
Jorah always calls her Khaleesi.
Khaleesi, yeah. My queen. Or Daenerys. My queen. My queen of the friend zone, Khaleesi. Oh, fuck.
Oh!
And this is the only season I've been able to stand that guy. Every season before that, his voice just does my head in. I don't know why. There's something about
Jorah?
It, but yeah.
Oh, I love his voice.
There's this sketch on a comedy show years ago called The Classically Trained Actor, and everything he said was like, I am a classically trained actor. So it would be things like, please remove your car from the garage, like that kind of thing. And right. Jorah just reminds
perfect
me of that. It's just, it does my head in. But he's better this season.
He seems so terribly romantic this season. I don't know, there's something... I agree with you. I actually really like him a lot more this season as well.
Yeah.
He doesn't seem to be pining as much, but more of a, I have done my duty sort of a thing.
Yeah. I've always liked Jorah, man.
Digging it.
Oh, it was interesting that the Hound, you know, the Hound's such a gruff dude. Beric said at the end of the episode, we'll meet again, Clegane. And he was like, I fucking hope not. You know? but earlier, like, there was a moment of humanity right after right after Thoros was, you know, discovered dead. Mm. And Beric covers his face and the Hound comes and crouches, kneels next to him.
Dude, the Hound is dead. I'm sorry. You keep saying the Hound. The Hound is dead.
yeah, true. Sandor comes over and crouches down, kneels next to him and tells him, you know, they say it's not a bad way to die. Ice, you know, freezing to death in terms, like, you know, in relation to being flayed by the Boltons or burned alive by the Mad King or something like that. Like, you know, they say you go, you know, you stop feeling the cold before you die, and it's like sort of a peaceful way. You just kind of go to sleep. So it was interesting that the Hound was trying to comfort Beric there, like doing something comforting instead of being a dick for once, basically. It was just neat. Yeah. A lot of cool, like little cool things in this episode. But yeah, that's my number two.
Nice.
Really?
Nice. My number two is essentially the same thing. For me, it was the various one-on-ones that we got throughout this entire episode. And I felt like that's what almost every scene was in this episode, was a one-on-one between two different people. And as you're saying, the Eastwatch 7, those were in particular my favorite, because I feel like we got a little bit of character development and relationship development within each one of those characters, whether it's Thoros and Jorah, we've already gone through each one of them for the most part. Arya and Sansa and Littlefinger, even Brienne and Sansa. You know, everything was paired off in this episode. But specifically, what I really did flag was Tormund. I thought he was the pinnacle of the episode. And because he was getting so much airtime, when it did come to that scene where he was being dragged underwater and that fight, I thought, oh my God, this is it. And he was going out in such I think, Jason, you may have mentioned it, almost like a slasher pick horror movie sort of way to go, where I was expecting to see, like Jojen in the past, where I was expecting the hands to reach up and start disemboweling
ripping
him, ripping him up.
And the blade right on his neck.
The fact that didn't happen is just a testament to the power of Tormund Giantsbane.
Yeah, you don't get the name Giant's Bane for no reason. And also, it was more surprising as well because he was just speculating about the future and children. And it's
everything. Yeah, if this was The Walking Dead, he'd be gone.
They were teasing us with that too.
Yep,
absolutely. Yeah.
What I thought was especially powerful as well, though, is that he's this powerhouse. He's this massive guy who can take on anything. But the way the whites were working was to work as almost like little ants. You know, one got the neck, one got the arms.
Yeah.
And that's so much creepier because you just become overwhelmed rather than, you know, mano a mano. It's kind of like...
Yeah, it's like the riddle, would you rather fight one giant duck or 50 duck-sized horses, right? <Yeah. laughs> A horse-sized duck or 50 duck-sized horses.
Is that a well-known riddle? I've literally never heard that before.
We used to ask that to the actors at the Walker Stalkers.
That's
panels.
Oh, I think I might have heard. Okay, yeah, it's ringing bells now. But yeah, I thought that was it was a contrast horror, which I thought was quite cool. And it was another good moment of bros saving bros, which is like the theme of this episode is bros save bros.
As far as the relationships, you know, there was animosity between Tormund and Jorah, between the Hound and Tormund, you know, wildlings versus southerners, like all these disparities and divisions, and they really seem to all band together and overcome them one at a time in this episode, which was really cool to see.
Yeah, they got along really well, actually.
Lucy, I have to correct you. This episode, yes, bros saving bros, that is one thing, but we also saw one massive hoe saving all bros.
True. Bitches get shit
except
done,
for John.
Though.
She didn't save John.
Oh, that was heartbreaking.
Didn't she, Duncan?
Yeah.
Didn't she save John?
She did. Okay.
Then Lucy. The woman comes in at the end.
That's
number
right. No, you're number one.
That cup of tea seems like a
we
long
understand.
Time ago. Okay, so I had a few because I had a feeling we would cross over. I'm gonna go with the Zeds. I'm gonna go with the Whites. Generally, I just thought the way they were more human in their movement was fantastic. The idea that they can sort of act in this hive way is just so interesting to me because it makes it a much more sinister and less erratic threat, because I think the logical thing would be that there's this mass of kind of wild, awful zombies across the wall, but actually what they are is an army. It's not just a
coordinated,
and that's terrifying. And I think that the costuming and design of this whole episode was amazing. I particularly enjoyed the return of kind of northern wear, which I thought was quite good. You know, the boots and the big jackets and so on.
And Danny's nice winter coat too was pretty nice.
I've got it written down as Danny's Zoolander jacket.
Yeah,
it was pretty awesome.
Totally
kind of
Zoolander.
Like derelict.
Wow. Yeah, there was a little derelict going on.
The white derelict my balls.
You
Lucy.
Can derelict. I can derelict my own balls. I enjoyed that, and the design of the whites was cool. I thought, you know, sometimes with like The Walking Dead, if it's a big crowd, it's kind of much of a muchness. But with that, there was so many kind of different horrible mutated bodies. I thought it was really quite powerful. And the guy who got his jaw decked out by the snowball was just hilarious. Just like, huh?
Now all I can think now is the Night King. I'm just thinking, but all you need to defeat him is to turn left.
Yeah. What is this? A castle for ants? And they're like,
oh my god, this is
brilliant.
A new
Daddy,
level of stupid.
Unleash Magnum.
To be fair, Jon Snow has got Magnum down, man. That's it.
Yeah, he does. He lives in Magnum. Yeah, exactly.
The Night King has a little version of his own there, I would say.
Yeah,
he does actually look quite like Mugatu. Okay, yeah, I'm going to go down the rabbit hole and say he does look a bit like Mugatu as well, which kind of... Anyway, Zoolander, great film. Watch it if you haven't.
Love it.
And yeah, I felt that the zombies really paid off in this episode. I think we got a different sense of the White Walkers and the White Walkers and the Whites, and I felt that the threat became much more potent. Not just because of the dragon, but also because of the way that they conducted themselves. So that was good for me. That was my number three. And the derelict jacket and costuming was the other part of that.
The Night King developed the first keyboard tie. Okay. Jason, what's your number one?
We touched on this a little bit, but the exchange with Tyrion and Dany, especially the part where it started to get a bit heated and she said, one could be forgiven for thinking you're taking your family side in this debate. And he said, I am taking their side. You need to take your enemy's side if you're going to see things the way they do. And you need to see things the way they do if you're going to anticipate their actions and respond effectively and beat them. Now, I think he's conflating two points there, because you need to understand your enemy to beat them, which means getting, you know, knowing their motivations and their point of view. But taking their side sort of, that means that you're standing up for them or being compassionate or whatever.
Mm. And, yeah, you need to understand their side for sure.
Yeah,
he's more taking their POV, like their point of view, rather than...
Like, well, he's helping them, you know. Yeah. And maybe that's the right thing to do. I mean, I think maybe putting those two in a cell might have been okay, but I also thought maybe this is the time for Dany to just show some real strength. I don't know, but whatever the case, I still love that Tyrion is arguing for a more measured approach, and Dany is quick to just want to go off and fight. And I think that they're, at least the idea is that they complement each other well and they'll be a powerful force. Although so far they have lost some armies and a dragon, and they've done they've come out ahead. What did they come out ahead on? Oh yeah, when she actually did go in and burn up the Lannisters. So I don't know. I mean, I think Tyrion is great, and I like the measured approach, but it still remains to be seen whether he's going to be a huge asset or not, right?
There's almost this, like, with a trio, there's almost this, like, thing of the head, the hands, and the heart. And in a way, Tyrion's the head. I would say Jon is kind of the hands, because he's the action man, and Dany's the heart, in that she's got this temper and this fire to her.
And so the empathy...
Yeah, exactly. And it's kind of interesting watching the three interplay, because not one of them on their own will win this war, because Jon will always make stupid decisions.
The three heads of the dragon right there. The three different aspects of rulership, of leadership. Yeah.
Maybe that's what it means. Maybe it's not the literal dragons.
That's true. Yeah. But I mean, the literal dragons would be awesome.
Agreed. Oh. But we see the damn one right now. So
yeah, exactly.
I love that Tyrion, just that one little thing where he said, I am taking their side. Like, he didn't back down from her. And that's
key.
Was nice. Yeah.
You can't just be surrounded by a bunch of yes men. Right. Otherwise, you'll do a bunch of dumb shit. And as far as Tyrion and the toasted Tarleys, maybe he wouldn't have been as mad if he had the full spectrum of knowledge regarding their heirs available in their house, because, you know, he thought that it was extinguishing House Tarly with Sam being in the Night's Watch and Dickon being the only heir. But if we remember last year, Sam brought Gilly and baby Sam to his house and claimed that baby Sam was his son.
Yep.
So that would leave baby Sam in line of succession for inheriting the lordship of House Tarly, which is hilarious because it means a wildling is going to be the lord of House Tarly, and Randall Tarly hates the wildlings.
I could see that.
We are happening. Also forgetting Tala Tarly, his sister.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So we've not seen her in seasons, so we don't know.
And there's the question, who would it pass to? Would it be a male heir? Would they pass it to the female heir, who'd be the lady of House Tarly?
My first thought was imagining Randall Tarly, but she's a woman.
Yeah.
yeah.
That's a great name, Tala Tarly.
That is Tala.
Cool. Yeah, I had to look it up. I mean, I'm acting like, guys, are we forgetting about Tala? As though, like, we should all know who she is. But I didn't know she had a sister.
I didn't remember her name either.
No, but it's funny that, because I guess she is head of house at the moment. If the, you know, as far as she's concerned, you know, Sam's disinherited and Dickon is dead, but she was actually quite friendly to Gilly, I think, like, she and her mother
quite friendly. They were perfectly pleasant and lovely towards Gilly.
And mother, what about her? would she?
Well, yeah.
Maybe she's in charge.
Acting Lord, yeah.
That's a good question, actually,
I was wondering about that, too.
I mean, I'm British, and I can't even tell you how the laws of succession really work here. I'm just like, I don't know, like, pretty stupid either way, but whatever.
That's all I had, just a little bit about Tyrion there.
Excellent. Okay. Duncan, numero uno.
Before I give my number one, I just want to mention something real quick. We talked about the dragon and what a major loss that was for everybody this week, and obviously really heart-wrenching and sad. But I wanted to bring up that we had a listener who lost a good friend of his this week as well. His 15-year-old dog, Mary Nick. Jane, our friend Nick. So I just wanted to give him a shout-out and let him know that we all feel your pain this episode, brother. So just hang in there and keep your head up.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It's rough, man.
Oh, it's horrible.
We're sorry.
So sorry.
Yep. Okay, so my number one is the John and Danny stuff. Ice and Fire, finally coming together. I thought it was really cool how, you know, she was so motivated to get up there and save the day, and she finally lands and they make eye contact first, and John runs over and reaches up to try to grasp her hand, and he can't reach, and then he has to save everybody, and it's like they're so close to, you know, connecting physically.
Flying off into the sunset.
Like, flying off, you know, and then I was expecting him to fly off on Rhaegal after that, like, oh no, he's got to mount his own dragon to get out of here,
you
know
what I mean?
Which would have been real cool. But after he tumbles into the water, she's forced to fly off, and she's just distraught on her face, and she's perched atop the wall waiting for him, which is really cool. Like, she couldn't leave without him. And
that scene reminded me of Princess Leia for some reason, just staring off at the end of Empire Strikes Back with Han Solo and Carbonite.
Yeah, good call. I love you. I know.
There's something so just vulnerable about the way she was like, just a minute more or whatever. You know,
yeah. Yeah.
Just,
like,
and speaking of vulnerability, when she said, I hope I deserve it to John after.
Right.
I didn't mean to steal your thunder, but, you know, he goes ahead and says he'll accept her as queen.
No,
that vulnerability we don't see very much in her anymore, and that just shows how much she respects
trusts him.
Yeah.
That was honestly the first time I felt genuine chemistry between the two of them.
Yeah,
in that moment at the end there with the whole hand holding, first him grabbing her hand, then her grabbing his hand.
Yes, I was going to mention that too. Yes,
that may really very cool. well have been like the most romantic moment of the series so far. I was kind of like, okay, I know we're cheering for incest, but that kind of rocks. Okay,
we're just gonna have to accept that as normalcy for
pretty
the
much. Yeah. I'm having a little bit of a hard time with it, but that was pretty sexy going on there. And I think that her seeing all the scars and like, as you talked about, Jason, the respect, gaining the respect of these two. I think when she saw all of that, she's kind of like, oh shit, he's been through the shit, you know, so he has been wounded. He literally has been stabbed in the heart because, look, that's a really unhealed wound.
And her face when she saw it, too, is just amazing.
And her, I feel like saying, I now have seen.
We had to come to see it.
I promise now that I'm going to fight the Night King and destroy them.
Yeah.
That's when John then can accept her as the queen. That's why, because now, you know.
And I feel like for her to accept him as a potential mate, he had to accept her first, essentially, you know, so I felt that played in there. But when she, you know, John says, I'm sorry, like, I wish I could take it back. I wish we never came up here. And she says, you know, no, I don't regret it.
Sorry,
like,
yeah.
I'm not sorry. Yeah, I had to, it's the type of thing you have to see it to believe it. I think that was like a double reference to the whites and to like his scars and everything on his
torso. Nice. Like, they've been playing like this emotional Jets and Sharks thing where they're like doing this dance around each other emotionally, you know, and finally now it's like, I've just met a girl named Maria, and there's Danny, and he's all really into it. So
considering the like sped up pace lately, I think they've done a pretty good job of showing that courtship.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, I really like it.
And I think his apology meant a world to her because it admits his flaw. Well, it wasn't even a flaw. I mean, she said herself, you know, I wouldn't change it, but
it showed a sensitivity towards what's important to her.
Yeah, and it was his instinct wasn't to say be defensive. His instinct was to be, oh my God, I'm so sorry. And that, I think that would have really touched her.
Well, and also all of these insecure sons of bitches, they all want validation, right? So at this point, he's giving her some validation. She's giving him some validation. There's this mutual respect happening between the two, which is really, I think that was the key. That's probably always what's been missing in almost all of these relationships in all of Game of Thrones, except for Ned and Catelyn. They actually had respect for one another. So I don't know. Maybe that's key to a relationship. Who'd have thought?
They most definitely have a mutual respect. She considers him a hero. He considers her a hero. Obviously, flying in fucking dragons.
Hero Shmiro. She's had pain. He's had pain.
That too.
That's gonna bind somebody more than anything else. You know,
they have all kinds of reasons to.
They do.
Be hot for each other. They're both young and good looking.
Aunt and a nephew. It's hot.
That's not exactly what I was thinking.
What? No?
I keep trying to justify it in my head. I'm like, but like, you know, Danny's never met her brother, so it's kind of like, I mean, he was a lot older. I mean, it's like, you know, and then I'm like, oh, just fuck it. It's incest, but whatever. It's
genetics.
But it's...
Lady Lysa wanted to marry Sansa to Robin Arryn, her cousin, so it's not even like too far out for... regular families. Tywin Lannister married his cousin Joanna.
Yep.
Like, so I mean, it's, you know, it's not like
non-core,
a,
you know?
in this world, yes. I think in our world, our brains are still trying to process because we're all like, Appalachia. Duncan, was that everything on your number one?
Let's see. There was one other moment which was really cool where, first he grabbed her hand, then she grabbed his hand, and then she was like, she kind of pulled back and was like, "You should rest." And as he closed his eyes, she sort of began to stand up, and just for a millisecond, a micro expression, just a glimmer of glee for like the interaction that they just had, and then it immediately turned back into like worry and you know, melancholy from the events that had just happened. But I think that Emilia Clarke did just a spectacular job in this scene with her facial expressions and her expressiveness. It, like this, go back and watch it right after she tells him to, you know, get some rest. There's just a glimmer, like the briefest little glimmer of happiness. And then she gets up to leave, but it was really cool. I just really liked their interaction.
They both gave good face this episode, I think. Like John's face when Danny arrived in the battle was great. It was that kind of triumph.
Yeah.
In the midst of all this chaos. And yeah, I think her eyes are just, like, there's something about Emilia Clarke's eyes. You're just like, oh, yeah, it was brilliant, that bit.
And Danny only accepts suitors who are already on their knees. So now that John has bent the knee, he's good to go.
I did love that. I did love that line where he's like, "I would bend the knee, but yeah."
That was funny. Oh, yep. I felt so bad for Tyrion when she's like, "Oh, he's too little for me."
Oh, buddy.
He's used to it.
I know, but still.
And the funny thing about that, too, is that she doesn't even mean it. She's just coming up with something to say.
Some excuse.
He's like, you're busted. You like John. You know? Yeah. She's like, no. I don't like John.
My friend was trying to figure out who I like, so he just started naming girls. And the only one that I actually did like, I said no. And he's like, well, I know it's her because that was the only one you said no. And I was like, damn it.
Yeah, there you go. Same thing right here. Danny and John sitting in a tree.
Aww.
That was cool. She's gonna make the announcement that John has bent the knee, or that's what John thinks the announcement's gonna be, and instead she's gonna announce that they're betrothed, and he's gonna be like, "Whoa, okay."
Wait, what happened?
Hang on, what?
Like because he bent the knee, you know, theoretically. That's going to have to, that news is going to have to come out, you know, but instead of coming out the way that he thinks, she's going to interpret bending the knee as marriage proposal. So it's going to, that's going to be the announcement instead.
They got to declare their love for one another. He's got to grab her and pull her in for a nice big wet kiss or something.
Yeah, that'd be cool. I could get behind that.
God, you guys, you're such shippers. God, talk about being girly. Jeez.
I just usually like usually Danny. Not, but I'm just living vicariously.
Jason, you are the biggest John and Danny shipper. Do not say that you're not. You're like, oh,
no, I'm usually not, but now, but I have been with these two for sure.
You totally are. It's really
Rick
funny.
And Michonne, I was too.
Yeah, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you were, weren't you?
Rick Schoen.
Rishon.
Yeah, so that's my number one.
Very nice.
Fire, baby.
Very nice. My number one was the Battle of the Frozen Lake, and then I shifted it over to Danny and John, and then I've been sitting here trying to think if there's anything else I can think of that we haven't fucking covered in this episode, but good God, we've already talked about this longer than the original episode actually went on. So, anybody have any notes?
I had a couple of things.
Yes. I knew you would.
Just a couple, though. So, I thought it was interesting that Danny invoked her brother, and in the same episode, you know, she said
that her namesake died.
Yeah. That Viserion. And also, she also talked about Drogo, and there's Drogon. And then we have Rhaegal, who is named after Jon Snow's real father and Danny's brother Rhaegar, which who was it said he didn't look like his father. So
Beric.
It's sort of the family thing that we mentioned earlier in this podcast ties in with all the dragon names too.
Yeah, so cool, man.
Another thing, Danny mentioned that she might meet Cersei, and I hadn't even thought about that, but it sounds like there may be a meeting coming up, because now they actually have to kind of negotiate with each other, not just fight. So that'll be pretty cool to see.
And you know what's going to happen at that moment too is that Cersei's going to realize that she misinterpreted the prophecy, thinking that Margaery was a younger, more beautiful queen, and she's going to see Dany and be like, fuck, I destroyed my biggest potential ally.
Yeah.
Fucked myself over. Like,
somewhere in the afterlife, Margaery's like, screw you, Cersei.
Did John ever meet Cersei?
I think Margaery's hotter, but that's okay.
John never met Cersei, but was near.
They were in there here, during the game, because he was still the bastard.
Yeah, he wanted Ned was careful to keep John away, knowing that he was a Targaryen kid, basically.
Yeah.
Kept him out of sight of Robert.
Sorry, hold on. Now I'm hung up on Jason saying, really, you think Margaery was you find her more attractive than Emilia Clarke? Well, Daenerys and Margaery, yeah?
Yeah, I mean, you know, Danny's nothing to scoff at.
They're both gorgeous. Absolutely.
Oh, fair enough. Yeah, they're both gorgeous. For some reason, I was like, wow.
Absolutely. Then last, I think it's cool that I thought this season would be more about winning the throne and the next would be about fighting the White Walkers for some reason.
Right.
But they're doing it all at the same time. And I'm like, oh, yeah, obviously that's the way to do it because it's so, so good.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
Yeah, amazing. Oh, and one more note, Ramin Djawadi is just fucking killing the soundtrack on this. Like, he's doing so well.
Yeah.
Music has just been amazing.
The swelling, amazing fighting moments and the little tense things.
Right.
And,
like when John looks up and sees the Night King.
It's
like,
best not to have any music.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I have a couple of notes, but they verge on nitpicks. So if you edit them out, I won't be offended by this. I have written down this whole plan is stupid, but I think that was a bit harsh and that was me being grumpy. But I was a bit like, oh, there's quite a lot.
You got a point there.
I think it is that thing where you have to let go of some of it. Other random gripes I have were Titanic moment for Benjen when he's not allowed on the horse, but we covered that. The main thing I had, and I don't know if the death of Viserion compensates for this, but I feel like there's a slight, it's almost like The Walking Dead in that we're having a slight red shirts issue in that there are so many red shirts that I'm starting to be like, seriously, are we not going to lose anyone? And it's fine because I don't want the people I care about to die. But in this episode,
they feel too safe though.
Yeah. And I did think, you know, if Tormund goes, that would be an epic loss. Do you know what I mean? And I was happy if he didn't.
Well, you know what though? I mean, I've kind of felt like that a little bit this whole season.
Exactly.
But with Viserion, I mean, that's a big one.
That's the thing, and that's why I'm kind of hesitant to be like, this is crap, it's so many red shirts. But the other thing that I think Peter pointed out was he's like, God, under all that northern gear, everyone kind of looks alike, so I don't know if the red shirts are there just to throw us and make us think that somebody else has died, or if it's just really confusing because everyone's got a beard.
They never really focused in on them, so and they kind of were hooded, and
I was also a bit fuzzy on just how many there were, because we saw a shot of the seven, and then there was a shot with more. I counted about 10 or 11, but then I think we lost more red shirts than there were.
I think it was 13 total.
Yeah. And they had at least one scout further up ahead at one point, and there's probably people out on the flanks and maybe one guy out in the back. So there's more guys than we ever saw together at one point, theoretically, yeah, until the big Frozen Lake battle.
And I think, as I say, it's one of those things, I'm saying it, but I'm also like, oh, do you know what? I don't actually, I'm not sitting here like really angry about it. I just think...
Doesn't matter.
Yeah. Until up to Viserion, I felt a bit like, oh, come on, someone, we have to lose someone. You know, Thoros is a loss, but emotionally, he's not that much. I mean, no, yeah, I would put my cards on the table and say emotionally, that's not so strong. I think practically it is, because you lose the capacity to be revived. But in terms of the emotional impact, it's
so less. Which of the four of us would you not really care about that much?
Oh, well, good question.
I'm just kidding.
Well, I'm Scottish, so she cares about me.
Don't answer that.
At least to some degree.
Please don't.
Please note that I did answer, but Jason edited it out.
No, you know,
it was me.
I had a bit of a theory. I had a bit of a theory going into this episode that it was going to be Sandor that was going to die, and Beric would give up his life.
Yes, I did too.
To bring him back. That's kind of.
I think
part
that's
of what
still
going to
happen. Beric said, "We will meet again, Sandor."
Well, yeah, but the priest is gone.
Fucking hope.
So,
yeah.
Except for Melisandre.
And there were some theories going around, and I could kind of. I think this would have had good narrative impact. Was that the white that they brought back would be one of the seven? Like, it's...
I thought so, too.
Yeah, yeah. I really thought
there
might
was
be Jorah or the Hound.
I thought it was going to be Jorah. Yeah.
There was a really interesting moment I wanted to mention, too, where when Beric and Jon are talking, and Beric says to him, you know, the Lord of Light brought us back, you and me, just the two of us, no one else. And right when he said that, the Hound stepped into the frame behind Beric, bigger, looming over him. And it signified to me that the Hound is important. And I feel like, you know, the conversation where they had where... The Hound tells Beric, or Sandor tells Beric, that, you know,
thank
there's
you.
Nothing special about you. You're all, nothing special about you. You can't fight great. You know, you're not necessarily like smart or clever. Like, it's because he's just a placeholder for the Hound, who is special, who can fight really well, who's going to be key coming up somehow. And Beric is going to save him somehow. Beric is here just to save the Hound, I'm pretty sure.
I'm convinced Sandor's here to save Arya somehow.
Yeah, that could be too.
I don't know why. I've been hanging on to that. I miss the days when it was the Arya Hound show where the two of them were roaming around. I thought that was one of my favorite bits of this entire saga.
What the fuck's Salami?
What the fuck's Salami?
There's so many great
He's
moments.
Actually the actor Rory McCann is awesome. He did
amazing.
A few years ago they did a showing of Blackwater at a local film festival. And he came along and answered questions and was generally just really chatty. Like, a lot of his family work on the show as well. I think his, like, sister and brother-in-law are part of either the costume or the set department. This is all horribly factually inaccurate, and I'm sure someone will write in and be like, actually, there you work on this. But he's a really charismatic kind of guy, and I think he plays that part so well. Taciturn, angry.
Yeah, I have
Scotsman.
Some interesting Rory McCann information in the news as well. So
brilliant.
Looking forward to that.
Yarp. Okay.
Yarp. Narp.
I think... Anybody else have any other notes?
No, I think that's pretty much it.
All right, very good. We're going to take a quick break. There's more to come. Stay with us.
Underneath this canopy of snow, where 57 winters took their toll, I believed in you, I believed in you, like Elvis Presley singing psalms on a Sunday. Where did you go? Oh, well, she's gone to meet her maker, back to where she came from, come to save her soul.
All right, we're back, and it is now time for news about Game of Thrones.
Indeed. I got a bunch of stuff, so I'll try to move quickly considering it's super late and whatnot. Okay, so season 8, pre-production underway at Game of Thrones location in Northern Ireland. Game of Thrones first assistant director, Charlie Endine, says he's already at work on season 8. Crews have been spotted at work in Moneyglass, Ireland at the Winterfell exterior set, and there's reports that it looks like they're doing construction of some kind there currently. And Nikolai Coster-Waldau has confirmed that shooting begins in October. So they're on track to get moving with that quickly, which is good. Next in the news, Game of Thrones director Alan Taylor breaks down the timeline in Beyond the Wall. And this is the most negative thing I've ever said or I'm going to say about Game of Thrones. This is the one thing where they fucked up big time, in my opinion. And he basically does nothing here to change my opinion at all about it. So he says, "We were aware that timing was getting a little hazy," Taylor told Variety. "We've got Gendry running back, ravens flying a certain distance, like 1,400 miles down to Dragonstone from Eastwatch, dragons having to fly back a certain distance. In terms of the emotional experience, Jon and company sort of spent one dark night on the island in terms of storytelling moments. We tried to hedge it a little bit with the eternal twilight up there north of the wall. I think there was some effort to fudge the timeline a little bit by not declaring exactly how long we were there. I think that worked for some people. For other people, it didn't. They seem to be very concerned about how fast a raven can fly, but there's a thing called plausible impossibilities, which is what you try to achieve rather than impossible plausibilities. So I think we're straining plausibility a little bit, but I hope the story's momentum carries over some of that stuff. He says, it's cool to know that the show is so important to so many people that it's being scrutinized so thoroughly. He continued, if the show was struggling, I'd be worried about those concerns, but the show seems to be doing pretty well, so it's okay to have people with those concerns. Okay, first of all, so if the show's doing well, that means that concerns of legitimate logistic problems don't matter.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, it's 1,400 miles, essentially, from Eastwatch down to Dragonstone. So it would have taken a few days for Raven to get down there and then Daenerys to fly back up, at least. So I wouldn't say it was necessarily a jumping the shark moment for the timeline of the show, but it was definitely a dragon flying over a wall moment.
Okay. Let me give you two quick explanations. One, Gendry's the Flash. Two, the ravens are magic.
Okay.
That's it. You just need magic. Magic takes care of everything. And the dragons, I don't think it would take them that long. They're fucking big.
Wonder if Daenerys is like the easy jet of, you know, Westeros, and that's how people are getting everywhere so quick, is she's got a side business where Viserion and Rhaegal just take people places. It's like, get somewhere quick.
It's like the Uber Concord.
And now Viserion will be carrying the Night King over the wall.
Sansa mentions, she specifies how long Jon's been gone, kind of. She says, I think she says either months or weeks. She's like, Jon's been gone weeks or months.
Weeks, I haven't heard from him.
She says. She's been gone.
And I was like, okay,
weeks.
That gives us a little indication that this didn't all happen in the space of a fortnight, but, you know.
She said, I haven't heard from him in weeks. So she's probably heard from him when he was at Dragonstone. It's probably been, you know, a good while. He's probably been gone a couple months total, I would estimate. Okay, so next, Tom Hopper talks Dickon. Jane Goldman says what she can about the spinoffs, and cinematographer Robert McLaughlin keeps Kit Harington's feet on the ground. When Tom Hopper took, this is from WatchersOnTheWall.com, when Tom Hopper took a role on Game of Thrones, he had a sneaking suspicion he wouldn't be long in the world, because after all, it was Game of Thrones. He says, I like his attitude towards this too, it's good. This is the guy that played Dickon. He says, it's fine, because I think you go into a show like that, and as long as you have a good run, you get a few episodes out of it, it's great, it's a bonus. Hopper, who'd played Dickon Tarly, said in a recent interview with Elle, that I had a great time on it and had a few episodes where I got to do a lot of good stuff. I was very fortunate, I thought. So taking it like a champ, you know, he's got the right episode, right attitude going into this, that it's a limited gig, just awesome to be on the show in general. So good for him.
He's also awesome in Black Sails. He plays Billy Bones.
Right. Yeah, I mentioned that too, that he was sort of like a immediate hit because of his previous role on Black, or his current role on Black Sails, where, you know, people like him there too. Okay, so Jane Goldman, known for writing the Kingsman Secret Service, X-Men First Class, and Kick-Ass, is writing a pilot for one of the spinoffs.
I love all of those.
Nice. So that's good news for you. She says, I think as a book reader or as someone who watched the series, you would say, talking about the subject of what the spinoff will be, oh, that, okay. She said, yeah, it would be recognizable as a past event, but I think that's probably as far as I can go. She added that the magic and supernatural creatures that Thrones viewers love might certainly, like that's not a contradiction, be a part of her spinoff, since they're things, quote, that exist in the universe that George has created, and that's an aspect that I love. She says, I'm sure there's an element of that in anything that's being developed, but yeah, I feel like I'm saying way too much. I can say absolutely nothing. And she basically said absolutely nothing. So we learned nothing, we know nothing, we're all Jon Snow, as it happens with the spinoffs.
Oh, next. But yeah, I forgot to mention too, he was asking Beric Dondarrion, you know, why did I come back to life, and
right.
What are we supposed to do? And he goes, I don't know. And he goes, that's all everyone ever tells me, that I don't know.
Yeah. Great. I didn't even catch that.
They keep saying it. Why?
You know nothing, Jon Snow. You know nothing, Jon Snow. I know some things.
I know some stuff.
I know, I know some stuff.
I'm the shield of the guardsman, okay?
Yeah. Okay, next. Emmy Award-winning cinematographer Robert McLaughlin also talked about the challenges of filming in a studio versus out in the elements, and how star Kit Harington had to literally be tied down for an iconic shot in the last episode. A great case in point is the one where Jon's on the bluff at Dragonstone, and Dany comes in, and Jon meets the dragon. He said, the problem was that there was a howling gale blowing, and it was blowing towards the ocean off the land. In fact, it was blowing so hard that we had to put a safety cable on Kit Harington when he was meeting the dragon, because his cape, which is a very heavy fabric, was about to turn into a kite. We were afraid it would blow him right off the cliff. I'm not kidding. Wow. It was that windy.
Sorry, well, can we go back to the bit where Kit Harington got tied up?
Not that kind of... You're welcome. Just let your brain wrap around that one for a little bit. Yep. Next, Game of Thrones, Jerome Flynn on what drives Bronn and which Lannister brother he prefers. Oh, in case you guys didn't know, after he shot Drogon a couple episodes ago, Jerome Flynn's postman stopped talking to him.
Oh, no.
And people have been giving Jerome Flynn shit, like, oh, turning against the dragons, you know, Bronn, you bitch. But they need to realize that by shooting Drogon with that scorpion, Bronn saved Drogon's life, because now Drogon knows how to zig and zag. And mm-hmm. He avoided that spear from the Night King. So thank you, Jerome Flynn, for shooting Drogon with the scorpion.
Yeah, training. Okay. It's called training.
Yeah. So better to practice with spears than ice staffs, apparently. So how does Jerome Flynn feel about being left out of the mix for Jon and company's adventure beyond the wall? He says, I would have loved that. I would have loved it. He confesses, I tried to avoid scripts, so I didn't know what was coming. I just read the bits that I need to read. I was thinking, I wish I was with them. I was just thinking, wow, this is a great mix of guys to throw together on that journey. That's where my focus was. But of course, I would have loved to go out with them. Given the number of fan favorites that we'll have to worry about on the next episode, I'm just fine. Bronn is staying safe in the South, the author said. Next, on the subject of the Lannister brothers and which one does Jerome Flynn believe Bronn would side with if he was forced to choose, he said, well, he might say it depends who pays him the most, but I'll put it this way. If he was in a battle and found himself in a position of whose life he's going to save, who knows, but I probably think it would be Tyrion.
Yeah.
I think he can relate to Tyrion in a certain way and has some respect for him for what he's been up against in his life and how Tyrion has dealt with it.
Because last week, I guess they were, maybe it was in the script, or they had talked about filming the scene where Tyrion and Bronn meet up first, you know, because then...
Oh, that'd be cool.
Tyrion had asked Bronn to get Jaime, and that actor was disappointed that they didn't go ahead and film that, because he feels like Bronn likes Tyrion the most.
Yeah, and I was saying that last week in an episode too, that, you know, Bronn needs to go join Tyrion because he's on the losing side and he likes Tyrion more, so it'd make more sense for him to, you know, go over that way.
Mm-hmm.
But he says he thinks...
But Jaime can get him the most gold.
Right, he says he thinks there's a fun, like a certain fun aspect to Jaime too, but I think he thinks it goes much deeper with Tyrion. And it says, so the article says, Jaime better get working on that castle he promised if he hopes to keep Bronn's loyalty.
I think ultimately as well, like, I don't like saying this because Jaime's one of my favorite characters, but he's not the sharpest tool in the shed. And I think Bronn is quite sly, and he respects...
Quite sly.
Smarts.
As Leslie Jones said on Game of Jones.
Game of Jones, bloody hell, I love that.
Bronn's the guy in the hood that knows where all the $1 cigarettes are sold. You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
So two more news items. One, Game of Thrones actor talks about fighting with a flaming sword. the actor who plays Beric Dondarrion, I think it's Richard Dormer or something Dormer.
Richard Dormer.
No relation to Natalie Dormer.
Okay.
He says, it was like running a marathon in about 40 kilos of armor and sealskin with only one eye and a flaming sword that kind of blinded my one good eye, Dormer told Variety. It was hellish, but it was worth it. Hard work. It took us 5 weeks to film that battle sequence.
Oofed.
Complicating matters even further was the fact that Dormer's flaming sword was not enhanced by computer graphics, but was in fact entirely real. He said, the sword is not CGI. That's real flames every time, every single time. It lasts 2 minutes, so I could only use it for 2 minutes, and then it would start to go out, so we had to start all over again. Wow. Also, I had to slow my sword arm down by about 20%. So if I was doing a move, I would just have to do it. I would just do it quick with a sword, but with the sword on fire, you can't move that fast. Otherwise, the flame will go out.
Yeah.
So you've got to move just slightly slower, but more effort, you know? Also, it weighs 3 times as much as a normal sword, so it's just this big club, really.
Whoa.
Yeah, he goes on to say, it's so weird because at Comic-Con back in 2012 or 2013, someone asked me, what would you most like Beric Dondarrion to do in the final season? And I said, I want him with his flaming sword riding on the back of a dragon. And it came true.
Oh my God,
so that
did.
Was pretty cool.
You're right.
So that was pretty cool, Dormer said. What I would love to do is fight one of two people, the Mountain or the Night King. And I know I would definitely be killed by the Night King, but I might have a chance against the Mountain. And we know, in show continuity, he's fought the Mountain twice at least and was killed by him twice. So, okay, and our last piece of news also comes from Vanity Fair. Game of Thrones, see the surprising stunt that injured the Hound. It wasn't dragons, White Walkers, or even hand-to-hand combat that did Rory McCann in. Rory McCann gave an interview published in early August, all while pressing an ice pack on what interviewer Benji Jones describes as, quote, one of his tree trunk legs. McCann gave Jones some excuse or another for the injury, but before finally confessing, okay, it was from the show. I can't tell you exactly how, but I had this guy on my shoulder for days and days. It didn't work with a dummy, so I had to carry a real guy, and we had to run and run. No wonder I'm fucked. So he says, some days were actually brutal. The stoic McCann says, though he may have been referring to how the group... before we get here, like, obviously it was him carrying around the white that they had captured in this episode. He was, it took 5 weeks to shoot it or whatever, and it just killed his knee, I guess.
Oh my God.
Some days were actually brutal, the stoic McCann says, though he may have been referring to how the group was forced solitary McCann to bond with his co-stars. Normally, when we're filming, I hide. I don't drink, I don't smoke, and I'm used to living on my own on a boat off the west coast of Scotland. With the other cast, it's been like ships passing in the night. McCann said filming this season forced him to socialize for the first time, quote-unquote. But because he doesn't watch the show himself, he was at a loss meeting some of his newer, but not that new characters. Who's that big guy over there? He recalled asking his fellow castmates, is he a good guy or a bad guy? Who are you? The responses he got were mixed, including, are you fucking joking? We've been here on the show for 3 years, man. Another little funny thing from Rory McCann talking about his latex facial prosthetic for the burns. Mm. He says, with the latex, you sweat whether you like it or not. You're all wrapped up in some heated trailer or makeup truck, and then you go out on set and it's freezing. Then the sweat underneath your latex freezes.
Ooh.
So that sounds like a lot of fun.
I'm sorry, I got to interrupt real quick. Did you notice that when they were taking Jon Snow's clothes off, hearing the cracking
of the ice? Yeah, normal people would die being exposed to those temperatures for that prolonged time. I feel like Jon may be immune to ice and cold, similarly to the way that Danny's immune to fire and heat.
Maybe.
Or something.
Yeah. Sorry, for some reason that popped into my head as you were talking there. I'm sorry, go on.
Yeah, no, good call. That's important subject we didn't talk about. He was also underwater for a really long time. But while McCann may have abstained from board games, he did participate in the nightly musical jams led by Richard Dormer, Beric Dondarrion, on the ukulele, and Paul Kay, Thoros of Myr, on the guitar. So Thoros plays guitar. I was mistaken.
Dude, I would love to sit in on that jam session. Jason, calling right? How awesome would that be?
Play the congas.
Legendary. Yeah. calling themselves the Brotherhood Without Banjos. The group was joined by McCann, who sings, plays piano, mandolin, and yes, the banjo. We can all hope and pray that somebody caught this on video. Hell, I'd buy their album, the article says. And McCann says, the jams we had, I'll never forget. Sadly, with Thoros kicking the bucket this week and Beric staying behind at the wall, the Music Brotherhood is officially disbanded for now. And that is the news.
Yay.
Pretty cool.
Wow. Thank you. That fantastic. A lot of great stuff. Oh, my goodness. Look over there. Do you see all those ravens?
Now it's time for Raven's Calls. So first up, we have, Josh. I'm going to pronounce this wrong. Savanovich. I think I might do it in a voice, actually, just for fun, because, you know, I've been up for 2 hours and the sun is up. So Josh Savanovich says, I feel like I just watched Glenn beaten to death again, but by the damn Night King. What a powerful episode with astounding dialogue and character interaction. I'm interested to see if next week has any solutions or sets up the final wait.
Nice.
Oh, the final wait. Oh, that's horrible. Mm. What a good name for it.
I know. Jesus.
Brutal. It's going to be brutal. Michelle Jones says, no, 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 no. a dragon gone already? I cried. So many emotions during this episode. I laughed at the Hound, got scared for our Magnificent Seven, got mad at Arya for being an idiot, cried about the dragon, and loved the Dany and Jon interaction. The writers are killing me. But seriously, why a dragon gone already? Cry face.
Aww. Yeah, I feel you. I thought we were going to get the dragon riders first, but
I also yeah, I didn't think they were going to be gone this soon. Yeah.
Ashley Morris says, I really fucking prayed that the Night King wouldn't get a dragon, and I've never wanted incest before now.
True that.
Oh, so weird. Okay. Shane Yap says, of course the Night King got Viserion, named after her shit brother.
Right.
Jon will ride Rhaegal, his father Rhaegar's namesake, and Dany will be with her first true love's namesake, Drogon.
Yay.
Which will be renamed Snowgon.
Snowgon! Snowgon.
Oh, shit, that's good.
Oh, that's funny. Good. It would look Snowgon. Like Snow.
That would be his name if he got resurrected as a dead, you know, as a white dragon. Right. Then he would be Snowgon.
Snowgon.
Oh, well, that's Viserion, right? She brought him up because he called her Dany, so.
Yeah.
I've got Kay Deer. I'm still angry about them still writing Sansa and Arya as stupid little girls when they should be wise to Littlefinger by now. I'm angry about seeing the spoiler about the dragon dying. Me too. It was really spoilerific this week, guys. Ooh. Keep it cool. But, says Kay, that moment between Dany and Jon, man, how that touched my heart. The feels. I'm not even thinking about the, and I got incest part of it. Just the emotional bond between them. I could feel it through the television. Regardless of what form the bond takes, whether it be romantic love, platonic love, or the love between family, it was so intense and believable. Kudos to the writers, the directors, and to Kit Harington and Emilia Clarke. Bring on the finale. Ice and fire, baby! P.S. Here's a finger for Littlefinger. Finger emoji.
That's a interesting thing that, you know, their affection for each other could take different forms. It could be romantic love, platonic love, love between family. It kind of reminded me of during the Return of the Jedi when Leia is like, oh, I knew you were my brother the whole time. Like,
yeah,
just sort of knew it. Maybe they like have some sort of connection where they realize that they're related somehow or something.
Yeah,
I mean, there's nothing they to suggest
that.
But...
I'm pretty sure they just want to fuck.
Yeah, that's what I hope.
There. Yeah. Michelle Forbes says, I loved seeing Benjen again, but man, now we will never know what the hell he was doing wandering around north of the wall all these years. He was fire spinning, probably.
Brand could tell us.
Yeah, ask Brand. And now they have an ice dragon. Will he now breathe ice? Ooh. Ooh. He can't still breathe fire, right? But Jon and Dany, though. Maybe he'll breathe blue fire.
Oh, that'd be so cool, man. Mm-hmm. Maybe he'll breathe ice and the other dragons will breathe fire, and when they connect in midair, the combination will create dragon glass that will drop down in razor-sharp shards all over the troops.
Wow. That's pretty good.
I like that.
Laura Sotolo, Sotelo, Laura Sotelo says, I can't even right now. So many emotions.
Matthew Allen says, hey, Jon Snow, you bastard. You forgot the dragon glass. Yeah.
He's not a bastard, though.
Laura Willie Swink says, hi, Laura. Review, I just got bit by a dead bear. Best dialogue ever. Question, does the Night King need to be a Targaryen to control a white dragon? Observation, many references to Jon and Dany about children and progeny this episode. Finally, exclamation, fuckity fuck fuck, not Viserion.
I love that.
Angelica, Karen also, since that's a Karen reference.
Yeah, no, right?
Yeah. Angelica Valadez says, he just had to throw that rock.
Yeah. Right? Damn it, Sandor. Right? First one wasn't enough. Ned Rogers says, dude, there's no way Gendry got to the wall, a raven got to Dragonstone, and Daenerys got there to save the day, all before the Magnificent Seven froze to death. No way. Just could never happen. Slap! Shut up, I don't care. That was awesome.
Ned has two personalities.
Yeah.
All right. And finally, Rima Joe says, I want Danny and John to have sex on this show more than I've wanted to have sex with anyone in real life.
Does Jeffrey Dean Morgan know?
I was going to say, I won't take that as an insult.
Now, in all fairness to Rima Jo, she had a lot more to say, but I just used that one line in this because that one made me laugh the most.
Yeah, that's classic.
All right, so we have one phone call here from Becky from Savannah. So, Becky, take it away.
Hey guys, it's Becky from Savannah. Just a couple quick comments on the episode last night. First of all, I would like to comment that it is 100% Danny's fault that that dragon got killed and is now a white dragon, because that thing was doomed from the day she named it after her little bitch-ass punk douchebag pervert of a brother. So it was bound to be on the enemy's side from the beginning. So way to go, Danny. All your fault. Secondly, I really was hoping there was like a moment whenever Danny was taken off with the dragons and Tyrion was there and he was kind of like jogging after them, and I thought, oh, is he about to like step up on one of the dragons and ride it and be like, no, Danny, I'm coming with you. I won't sit out of this battle too. And then, you know, he'd be the third rider and confirm, yeah, he's that theory that everyone has that he may be a Targaryen, but not going to happen, it seems. It seems that the third rider is going to be the Night King. So that's a little depressing. That exchange between the Hound and Tormund about Brienne was priceless. I loved that. And I loved that even Tormund was like, I want to have her babies. which is really just another way of saying I want to fuck her, but it was a little sweeter. I feel like that's as sweet as you know, a wildling can get. It was adorable, and they were hilarious, so that was great. And I know a lot of people have been commenting lately that the show's not killing off any of the main characters anymore, but I know for me, at least, I thought multiple times, I thought the Tormund was going to die multiple times. I thought the Hound was going to die. I thought Beric was gonna die, and I actually thought for a fleeting moment that Jon might die in the water and become a white.
Right.
So, at least if I still get that feeling and I'm like uncertain and I'm like, oh, you know, are they gonna die? I think that Game of Thrones still has its stride when it comes to that. So, I'm very happy with the episode. The dialogue was great. It sucks that the dragon died, but it's going to be really cool to have a dragon white in season 8 in, you know, 2028, whenever that season finally fucking comes out. So anyway, love you guys. Can't wait to hear the podcast. Bye.
Might be next week.
In terms of Tormund, I think it makes sense from the wildling perspective, like living beyond the wall. It's not that he just wants to have sex with her, which he totally wants to do, but they got to look for mates that'll give them hearty, strong children that'll survive.
He was excited that they'll have big children that can conquer the world.
Totally. And he, you know, he sees the value of that genetic heritage from Sir Duncan the Tall. You know, that's what it really is.
There you go.
Ah, he's just into her, man. He's just into her. She just butters his biscuit in the right kind of way.
He sees the way she looks at him.
It's exactly. Yeah. Like she wants to eat his spleen. Exactly.
He just likes her.
Thank you, everybody, for posting on Facebook and writing in. Sorry, we actually had a lot more things that did post, but as you all know, we have to trim that down because, good gravy, this is already going on very long. It would go on even longer if we responded to everything. So, All right, that's our show, episode 39. Thanks for listening, everyone.
Thanks, everybody. Just wanted to make a quick announcement. I think this might end up being the longest Podcastica episode so far, which is cool.
Podcastica episode? No, I think.
You guys have done like 4-hour ones, huh?
We've done a 3-hour one. Yeah, I think so.
I did an hour 59 minutes. Right. Still smug too at one point.
All right, let's keep talking. No, I'm just kidding. So, I do have an announcement. So, Bald Move has reached out to us and a bunch of other Game of Thrones podcasts. We're going to all do our own special episodes, and they're going to be released as part of a fundraiser for the, what do you call it? ACLU? Is that right?
Is that what it's called? Civil Liberties Union?
Yeah, yeah. And so that's going to... ours is going to be the top 3 moments from season 7, not counting the finale because that won't have aired yet when we record it, but everything else. And so keep an eye out for that. I'll have more information about how you can get it. So you got to donate to get it, but you get that plus all the, you know, you can get all the other from the other Game of Thrones podcast. And we're in very good company with that. So that'll be pretty fun.
Yeah, that's really exciting. Hopefully we make some good money.
Cool.
All right. Well, if you'd like to call, you can call us at 813-563-3739. That's 813-JOFFREY.
If you'd like to write in, you can email us at game@podcastica.com.
Check out our Facebook page at facebook.com/GOM podcast.
And be sure to check out the other great podcasts at podcastica.com. So next episode, we have the finale of season 7. And as far as I know, at least when I checked earlier today, they didn't have the title anywhere. It wasn't in IMDb or on Wikipedia, so they were keeping it a secret.
Awesome.
Yeah, how cool is that? Interesting. I like that this season.
And hopefully they won't leak it before Tuesday this time. So, all right. Yep. That's our show.
Thanks for listening.
And pour one out for Viserion, everybody, and we'll see you next week for the grand finale.
Woo! Yay.
Whoop, whoop.